Hi students, we are starting with our practical series of abnormal urine analysis, right? And in this class, we'll be discussing the first one, that is qualitative test for reducing sugar. Now, there are two things you should understand after following this lecture session. You will know all about the theory, right? But in order to master it, you should always go to the lab and practice it hands-on over and over again in order to have the eye estimation of how the test actually looks like. And number two, you may hear some noise around me when I'm speaking because some construction work is going on, right? So, this test is known as Benedict's test, the test for reducing sugars. Now, there is an importance in this apostrophe S, all right? Why? Because it's named after him, the scientist Stanley Benedict, right? He discovered the Benedict's reagent and it's after him, in his honor, we call this Benedict's test. So, henceforth, whatever test that mentions this apostrophe S is always named after somebody. So, if you, plain and simply, if you are ignorant and write Benedict test, it's wrong, right? You should give respect to the man, he's an American chemist. Now, let us look into the principle of this test. So, we are trying to diagnose or detect the presence of reducing sugars or reducing substances. There is a difference between those two and I will be discussing them. See, let us first look at the principle. You can pause the video and you can note it down. It says in alkaline medium, very important, right? In alkaline medium, which is provided by Na2CO3 or sodium carbonate, right? Reducing sugar tautomerizes to form inediol. Now, tautomerism is an isomerism between the keto form and enol form. So, reducing sugar has to tautomerize to form inediol, which is actually the strong reducing agent, right? So, this is the first part of the reaction that is happening inside. What this reducing agent does, it reduces cupric ion, that is Cu2+. It reduces cupric ion to cuprous ion, it will reduce Cu2+ to Cu+. The question is, where from the Cu2+ is coming? This cupric ion is actually provided by the copper sulfate that is present in Benedict's reagent. So, Benedict's reagent has got CuSO4. The crystal that we dissolve is CuSO4 5H2O and it's blue in color, right? Copper sulfate. And that is converted to cuprous ion. Now, as soon as it is converted to cuprous ion, what will happen? Cuprous ion will search for another anion. And what is the most common anion that is present in water? Yes, it is OH-. So, immediately these two will combine to form cuprous hydroxide. Mind it, cuprous hydroxide is insoluble. Cuprous hydroxide always has a tendency to get precipitated. And its color is white or yellow in color. But it is not precipitated in our test. We will not get a precipitate of cuprous hydroxide. Why? Because it's prevented by sodium citrate. So, sodium citrate is also there in Benedict's reagent. It prevents precipitation of copper hydroxide. So, what happens if we keep on heating copper hydroxide? What will happen? CuOH plus CuOH, one H and OH will be gone as water. And on further heating, it will form Cu2O. That's what we get as the brick red colored precipitate. So, which on further heating develops cuprous oxide, which is brick red in color. If you are having problem to visualize the reaction, here it is. See, glucose is converted to 1,2-NADOL. Why? Because it is the alkaline medium is provided by sodium carbonate. Right? So, this here the tautomerism is happening, this is the tautomerization step and this is the strong reducing agent, right? And it is reducing cupric to cuprous. Now, as a part, as a rule of any redox reaction, what happens? The reductant is itself oxidized. So, glucose is converted to gluconic acid. Gluconic acid is nothing but in the end, there is a CHO in case of glucose aldehyde. In case of gluconic acid, this aldehyde is simply replaced by a COH group. So, glucose becomes gluconic acid and cupric is reduced to cuprous. Cuprous combines with OH minus that is available in water to form cuprous hydroxide. But this precipitation doesn't happen because it is prevented by sodium citrate. Sodium citrate prevents. So on further heating, two molecule of cuprous hydroxide will condense to form cuprous oxide, which is brick red in color, and we get water as a byproduct, which is actually evaporated constantly as we are heating the sample. Mind it, we are constantly heating over here. Fine. So this is the principle of this test. Now, how do we do this test in reality? Before knowing that, an easy thing for you to remember and very important thing. So what are the stuff that is present in Benedict's qualitative reagent? It may be asked as a question. So it contains copper sulfate, sodium carbonate and sodium citrate. Each has got a very important role. Copper sulfate provides the cupric ion as a medium for it to reduce. Sodium carbonate provides the alkaline medium, and sodium citrate prevents the precipitation of copper hydroxide. So this procedure, you see, 8 drops of urine sample is added to 5 ml of Benedict's qualitative reagent in a test tube and mixed well. Fine. One very important thing, you should always write practicals in a passive voice. In many textbook, you may find add 8 drops of urine, add 5 ml of urine sample, but you shouldn't write in that way. Writing in that active voice, basically you are asking the examiner to add, which is not the case, right? So you, since you are adding, you should always make it a point that you are writing everything in a passive voice. So added is done, is mixed, is heated. So make it a habit. Now, after mixing those two things, it is then boiled for 2 minutes and then cooled under tap water. Now there are a few things to note. Whenever you are mixing anything, suppose you want to mix substance A and substance B, 1 ml of A and suppose 3 ml of B. As a dictum, you should always take the liquid which is more in volume first in the test tube. So in this case, we should always take first 3 ml of B, and to it we should add 1 ml of A. Logic is, you can ask, we are mixing 1 A and 3 B. If I add 1 first, then everything will get mixed ultimately, sir. Isn't the logic? No. Logic is logic, but dictum is dictum. So specifically in this case, you tell me which one is more. Definitely 5 ml of Benedict's reagent is more. So we should always take 5 ml of Benedict's reagent first in a test tube, and to it we should add 8 drops of urine sample. Remember, if examiner ever sees you taking 8 drops of urine sample in a blank test tube, he or she will simply mark you and you will face penalty. You won't even realize what you did wrong. Your result will be positive, but rules are rules. Next is then boil for 2 minutes. This is intermittent boiling. What you shouldn't do, you shouldn't set a stopwatch and you shouldn't put the test tube perpetually for 2 minutes. In that, what will happen, the stuff will boil and it will come out and then you will lose marks. Okay, so as soon as it starts to boil, you should always remove it from the flame, and remember, always hand over the test tube to the examiner if he or she insists after cooling. So cooling is very important. You should take care not to burn the hands of examiner. Okay, and during heating, very important, never face the test tube towards your own face or friend's face or any direction where a staff is standing, right? Liquid can get spilled and it can produce ugly burns. So you should always be careful. Always point the test tube in a direction where there is nobody, right? Next, the observation, very interesting. You see a brick red, orange, yellow, green precipitate is observed at the bottom of the test tube. Be very careful. So these are the possibilities. Either brick red or orange or yellow or green precipitate will be observed at the bottom of the tube. This is a textbook language. In your experimental setup, you will get only one color. So feel, be very careful. Don't mention all these colors in, I mean, as an alternative. You will get only one. Fine. And lastly, the inference, that is the conclusion, means the sample contains reducing substances. Mind it, this is not sugar. In principle, we discussed sugar, right? But we are saying substances. Why? There is a reason to that. We'll discuss later. Now, you saw these colors are appearing, right? And this is, there is an easy way to remember. You know the spectrum of rainbow, VIGGIOR, right? This is an acronym: we violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red. The reaction starts with blue color because Benedict's reagent is blue in color, and it will proceed towards green, yellow, orange, red. Why this is, there is a change in color? It's because the color actually depends on how much reducing sugars are present in the urine sample. So in 8 drops of urine that you are adding, what is the concentration of reducing sugar? So if there is no reducing sugar, the solution will remain unchanged, it will appear blue. If there are trace reducing sugars, it will be green, a bit high, it will give yellow, moderate to high, orange, and very high, it will give a brick red colored precipitate. At first, the solution will turn green fully because everything is mixed as you are boiling by convection current, but slowly if you keep the test tube, it will settle down as a brick red precipitate. So what is the meaning of this test, right? See, at the first, you can look, we are saying Benedict's qualitative reagent, right? So what do you mean by qualitative? Qualitative test, any qualitative test just detects the substance. So whether it is present or whether it is absent. If I am to detect protein by qualitative test, the qualitative test will only tell us whether protein is present or protein is absent. For example, we often do pregnancy card test, right, with urine sample. That is also a qualitative test, the card one. It will tell us whether pregnancy is there or not, whether the test is positive or absent or negative. However, the tests which gives you the exact values for pregnancy, we do HCG, human chorionic gonadotropin. For diabetes, we measure blood glucose. So the tests that gives you the exact values are known as quantitative test. Mind it, if you want to measure glucose by any qualitative test, it will just tell us glucose is present or absent. However, if you want to test whether the patient is normal, fasting, diabetic or very high, a glucose of 200, 250, 300, that we cannot tell by any qualitative test. For that, we need quantitative tests like hexokinase test or glucose oxidase peroxidase test. We'll be discussing them later in our lectures. But this test lies in the middle ground. Why? You can see, based on the amount of reducing substance, we are not getting the exact value, but we get some rough idea, right? So since we are getting some rough idea but not the exact concentration, this test behaves partly as qualitative and partly as quantitative. Hence, it is known as semi-quantitative test or semi-quantitative test. This is one unique test, and this is a question that will be asked in your practical viva. And you can see, as I showed you in the last diagram, this is the amount of reducing sugar that are approximately present in the urine sample. So remember it very carefully, Benedict's test is also a semi-quantitative test. And this is how it looks like in real world. Okay, so the Benedict solution is this blue in color, and as you start heating and depending on the amount of reducing sugar, reducing substances, this will be the color change from green to yellow to orange to red. Now we are coming to an alternative test. Suppose Benedict's test is not an option, or even examiner may ask you name an alternative test. Remember, the alternative test is Fehling's, F-E-H-L-I-N-G apostrophe S. Fehling's test, right? This is an alternative test. This is a purely qualitative test. It will not confirm the presence of anything. This is a test for reducing sugar. So if you ask me, what is the confirmatory test? Well, confirmatory test can be of two types. One test that will confirm the presence of carbohydrates only, that is Molisch's test, M-O-L-I-S-H apostrophe S, Molisch's test, right? It will detect the confirm the presence of carbohydrates. And if you are asking me, or if your examiner asks you how you can confirm the presence of glucose, that can also be done by many tests. For example, osazone test or glucose oxidase peroxidase test or hexokinase method. There are multiple methods. Osazone, GOD, POD, that is glucose oxidase and peroxidase, or hexokinase. These are specific tests for glucose only, right? However, if we are telling, just commenting that Benedict's reagent, I mean test is positive, Fehling's test is positive, it only gives us an idea about presence of reducing substances, nothing more. So that brings us to what can be the probable question. The first question that examiner will ask you is, okay, you are telling me reducing substances. So what is the most common reducing substances? Then your answer should be, the most common reducing substances are reducing sugar, right? then you invite another question. Examiner will then ask you, okay, what is the most common reducing sugar in urine? Then your answer will be, the most common reducing sugar is glucose. So most common reducing substances and most common reducing sugar. He or she will then ask you, okay, name some other reducing sugar. Then your answer can be galactose, lactose, maltose, all those fructose. And then he or she will ask you, name a non-reducing sugar. Then your answer will be sucrose. Okay, so you can see there are many questions that comes along with this. Okay, next question, examiner will ask you, okay, you are telling me all about carbohydrates. So what can be a non-sugar reducing substance? Can you name some non-sugar reducing substance that are not carbohydrate? It means they will give a negative Mollis test, but they will give a positive Benedict's test. Yes, those substances exist, and those are ascorbic acid, that is vitamin C, and homogentisic acid. Okay, this thing increases in a disease that is known as alkaptonuria. We will be discussing this disease in detail in protein metabolism class. So homogentisic acid and ascorbic acid are an example of non-sugar reducing substance. They are not carbohydrates, but they will give positive Benedict's test. Next, a question examiner might ask you, fine, so what is your probable diagnosis? Definitely the patient is suffering from glycosuria. Glycosuria means excretion of glucose in urine. So probably this is a case of glycosuria, and the disease that leads to glycosuria is diabetes mellitus. So Benedict's test is often positive in patients with diabetes mellitus because glucose is excreted in urine. If you have answered till now, then examiner will ask you one of the most tricky questions, and after you know this answer, you shouldn't utter that term unless you are asked. Okay, examiner will then ask you, what if the patient hasn't got diabetes but still Benedict's test is positive? Your first answer can be, yes sir, there are presence of non-carbohydrate reducing substances that may give Benedict's test positive. What if the examiner rules out these? So he is asking, patient is not having diabetes mellitus, but patient is having carbohydrates or glucose in urine, but not non-sugar reducing substance. So what can be the probable diagnosis? Then comes the role of an entity that is known as renal glycosuria. What is renal glycosuria now? Okay, glucose will be excreted in urine only if patient is diabetic. If patient is diabetic, we generally refer to a postprandial, that is fed state glucose or random blood glucose, more than 200 milligram per dl. It means if blood glucose level crosses this value, it will start to come out in urine. In reality, it is 180 milligram per deciliter. When blood glucose crosses 180 milligram per deciliter, we will always have glycosuria. This value is known as renal threshold, THRESHOLD. So renal threshold value is 180 mg per dl. When blood glucose level goes high, kidney is nothing but a sieve. Okay, there are pores through which things get filtered. So kidney will not be able to restrict glucose when the concentration is very high. So some has to pass through, and that value is 180 mg per dl. In some diseases of the kidneys, this renal threshold value may get lowered. Now imagine the renal threshold value is lowered and it is 120 mg per dl. Because kidneys are a problem, patient is normal, patient is non-diabetic. So blood glucose level, even if it's 130 mg per dl, which is completely normal in fed state, still, since the renal threshold value is lower, the filtering ability of kidney has been lost, glucose will start to come out in urine. We will have glycosuria, but that glycosuria is not due to diabetes mellitus, but it is due to a renal cause. So one reason of positive Benedict's test in very rare condition is renal glycosuria. But remember, this is very, very, very rare, and please do not utter this term when examiner asks you what is your probable diagnosis. The diagnosis is glycosuria, एंड प्रोबेबली डायबिटीज मेलाइटस, प्रोबेबली नेवर से ग्लाइकोसूरिया एंड डायबिटीज मेलाइटस, यू आर नॉट श्योर, देयर मे बी मल्टीपल डिजीजेस, फॉर एग्जाम्पल फ्रुक्टोसूरिया, व्हेन फ्रुक्टोसिस कम आउट इन यूरिन, गैलेक्टोसूरिया, गैलेक्टोसिस कम आउट इन यूरिन, ऑल ऑफ देम विल गिव पॉजिटिव बेनेडिक्स टेस्ट बिकॉज दिस टेस्ट इज नॉन स्पेसिफिक. बट रिमेंबर when examiner is ask you what can be your diagnosis or what is your diagnosis, you should always maintain an uncertainty. This can be a case of glycosuria due to diabetes mellitus, which is the most common disorder, but never ever utter renal glycosuria unless you are asked, because as a first year student it is not possible for you to know the causes of renal glycosuria. There are multiple diseases in which this renal threshold value will get lowered, but you should keep it reserved. If you are on the right track, then examiner will definitely ask you and assess you, and then it means you are already getting good mark. So remember, your evaluation of knowledge will be on the questions that are being asked and on the principle, whether you can, we actually know what the reaction is going on. There is no extra credibility in doing this thing properly. It means what? Any ABC technician can mix 8 ml, 8 drops and 5 ml and bring a positive reaction. There is no credibility in that. It means you are expected to do this thing correctly. But if you do it wrong, then you are heavily penalized. So there is a problem in both the way. But remember why Benedict's test is semi-quantitative test, what are the alternative test, confirmatory test, and what are the non-sugar reducing substance, and lastly, what is renal glycosuria. So with this, we end today's video. If you have any queries regarding Benedict's test, please feel free to hit the comment section, and I will see you soon with another video. Till then, bye and take care.